9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Now live.
89.5 WSKB.
From the campus of Westfield State University, this is 89.5 FM, WSKB, Westfield.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family. It's nice to know that even as the world changes, Dunkin' Coffee remains the same at 7 convenient locations throughout Westfield.
All right, welcome, Bobby G and Company. We got Mrs. Luna Bryant zooming in from the nether regions, and my buddy Peter Cole is producing the show from within, and welcome, good morning, both of you.
Morning.
Now, that was the Star Trek medley.
Morning.
Yeah, but it's in 2013. It would be vastly different nowadays.
Maybe, yeah, okay, but it's still an orchestration of, which reminds me, Pete, of the show that we saw in Springfield. With the orchestra when they did the sci-fi night.
Oh yeah, when Maestro Kevin Rhodes, he loves sci-fi.
There you
He's a Trek fan.
So the reason that I picked that for the opening today was because Star Trek actually aired the very first episode, which was called The Man Trap, on September 8th of 1966, which is Sunday, 58 years later. It initially had a budget. The season one budget was $190,000 per episode for the first season, and then it went down for the second and down even further for the third. 79 episodes were actually filmed in the original series, and it ended on June 3rd of 1969. So a little bit of Star Trek trivia for you there. And so this week, when I reached out to the different people associated with the show, I told them, I says, look, just give me your absolute favorite song. Excuse me. This is the one time I'll even play country. And everybody laughed at it. And Les called me on it. And so we're actually playing a Rolling Stones song later that is country. And I couldn't believe it that he found this. So, yeah. So these are the favorites. But we also have the final episode of season one of Legend Hunters that we're going to be playing for you right around the top of the hour. So I've got a ton of business to cover between now and then to keep us on track. So I'm just going to jump right into things with 46 seconds of your life that you're going to wish you had back.
What? What? Your name is Hugh Morris. What? Hugh Morris. What? Is that funny? Is that humorous?
What? What?
What? What?
What? What?
Get out of here!
Get out of here!
What? 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 What?
Cut that crap out.
What? What? What?
I hate that word.
What?
All right, so these are things that are celebrated today on National What Day. There's only two of them. Today's an easy day. I could get into the first one. I actually can get into the second one, too. The very first one is National Be Late for Something Day. And, yeah, I'm actually, you know, I don't know if I'm, I don't know. Lynn, am I somebody that's usually late on time or early, would you say?
Late.
Never early. I think you're 50-50.
Am I? Okay.
Yeah, right. A lot of times you cut it close in here, yeah. You're late.
Well, I cut it close, but that doesn't make me late. I'm sorry, Lynn, what?
That's because of his fan club.
Oh, that's what it is.
That's
exactly.
Because of your fan club.
Exactly. It's it's the recovering nymphomaniacs that are 21 years old, women that meet at the Pride Station in the morning that they just don't let me go. All right, so listen, your other national day, and this one I share this with the club, National Cheese Pizza Day. Kind of boring, but you know what? On occasion, I do like a plain cheese pizza. You know, I mean, I actually had pizza last night. And
depends on the type of mozzarella they use.
Okay. We ended up going to Pizza House last night. I just got a pepperoni and sausage pizza. And I was like, that's fine, because Hope was like, I'm not really hungry. I may have one piece.
I made a thin crust pizza with flour tortillas.
Okay.
A little bit of sauce, good mozzarella cheese, and deli-style pepperoni, the big pieces.
I like that. I don't like it on pizza necessarily, but I do like the sandwich.
Because what happens is the deli-style pepperoni exerts all that oil down into the pan,
okay.
Into the cookie sheet. And it basically cooks the bottom part, almost like fries it a little bit.
Oh, okay.
And it's nice and like a real crispy, thin crust pizza.
So do you put your pepperoni on top or below your cheese layer?
On top.
Okay.
Gotcha. So the oil has a place to go.
Gotcha. And that's it. Just those two for National Wet Days. So with that in mind, let's jump into Connie Talbot. We got some yesterday with things in history. Yesterday. As I enjoy my very first coffee of the day. Studio coffee, which I have not had in I don't know how many weeks. Seems so far away. Bobby missed it. Now it looks as though they're here to stay. Oh, I believe in yesterday. All right. Today in history. Today being the 5th of September. We got we go all the way back to the year 1666. The Great Fire of London ends. Now here's the deal. 10,000 buildings, including St. Paul's Cathedral, are destroyed, but only 6 people are known to have died. 10,000 buildings with 6 people. That's just incredible.
That makes the Great Chicago Fire look like a weenie roast.
Yeah. All right. The year was 1836. Sam Houston was elected as the first president of the Republic of Texas. Okay. 1882. We have the very first United States Labor Day Parade, and it was held in New York City. And 1960, I mean, I don't remember this. It's 6 years before I was born. Muhammad Ali, then called Cassius Clay, wins the gold medal in light heavyweight boxing competition at the Olympic Games in Rome. Wonder if they had to wear togas.
Hmm.
All right, the year was 1975. Sacramento, California. A follower of the incarcerated cult leader Charles Manson, who is Lynette Fromm, attempts to assassinate U.S. President Gerald Ford. Got two more for you. Actually, Pete, you're going to like both of them. 1977, the Voyager program. Voyager 1 is launched after a brief delay. And then the last one I got for you, 1984, STS-41D. The Space Shuttle Discovery lands after its maiden voyage. And that's your Today in History, the 5th of September. So we got some wildfire coming at you next.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you. Love you guys.
Love you guys too. That's Kay and Kel from Wildfire out in the Dallas, Texas area. Look them up on YouTube. So today being September 5th, if you were born today, we all wish you a very happy birthday. May you have the best day. And with that in mind, these are some people that share your birthday, whether they be famous or infamous. That's for you to decide. The year was 1735. Johann Christian Bach was born today. Passed away in 1782. The German composer. Everybody knew him. 1847 gave us Mr. Jesse James, passed away in 1882. He was the American outlaw, very, very famous. And here's one, Lynn, you being the runner of the bar. 1850 gave us Mr. Jack Daniel, who passed away in 1911. The American businessman who founded, you guessed it, Jack Daniels. Cannot drink that stuff.
Daniels.
Oh, my God, that stuff almost killed me in my days of youth. All right, the year was 1929. Mr. Bob Newhart was born today. He passed away in just this year in 2024. American comedian, actor, singer, and screenwriter. And, yeah, he passed away in July of this year. 1937 gave us William Devane, American actor, director, and screenwriter. And then here's one that most people are going to know who she was. 1940 gave us Miss Raquel Welch. Passed away in 2023.
Oh, yeah.
American actress and singer. I didn't know she could sing. I knew she looked good. And speaking of singers, 1946, Mr. Freddie Mercury was born today. Passed away in 1991. the Tanzanian English singer, songwriter, and producer. And I was kind of giving my wife the business for not picking a Queen song, but she didn't know it was Freddie's birthday. The year was 1951, and it's the last one I got for you. Mr. Michael Keaton was born today, the American actor, producer, and in my opinion, the best Batman. And that's your celebrity births for today. We had eight of them, so happy birthday to you. And let's jump into some Undertaker. We got some celebrity deaths, but only two of them. Your celebrity deaths again, September 5th. Going back, and there's only two of them, but they're big ones. Going back to the year 1997, we lost Mother Teresa. She was born in 1910, the Albanian-born missionary and humanitarian recipient of the Nobel Peace Prize. And in 1999, if you're my age or thereabouts, you're going to know who this guy was. Pete, I think you will too. Mr. Alan Funt. Passed away today, born in 1914.
Game show host.
American director, producer, and screenwriter, and he was the creator and the host of Candid Camera back in the day. That was kind of a cool show. I remember watching that with my folks as a kid. And there you go. That's your Today in History, celebrity births, celebrity deaths. Woohoo! So listen, we got, like I said to you, I'm cranking through things so that I can make room for Legend Hunters at 7. Or thereabouts. So the very first song I'm going to play for you is one of my favorites, and it kind of goes with the celebrity deaths. This one here is Blue Oyster Cult with, yeah, you got it, Don't Fear the Reaper. Bobby G and Company, we'll be right back. All right. Hey, that's what we needed to start our day off. Cowbells. Come on. Not enough cowbell in music today. All I can picture is that Saturday Night Live skit.
How cliche.
That, what was it? What's the guy? What the hell was his name? The Saturday Night Live skit that Blue Oyster Cult did with the comedian there, and he was doing a cowbell.
Oh, I think I know who you're talking about, but I can't remember his name either.
I can't think of it. It's eluding me. Anyway, we got some, you know, I mean, it's kind of early for cowbells, but it's not really if you think about it. But I did it to you before.
Oh, Christopher Walken.
No. The comedian.
He needs more cowbell.
Yeah, no. It was, he wasn't the one hitting the cowbell. Oh, man, what movie was he in?
I don't know. You think about it later.
He was in that movie with John Cena as a stepdad. I think it was stepdad was the name of it. I want to say Steve something, but I'm questioning even that. Curly hair.
No, I have no idea what you're talking
about. He was in Night at the Roxbury. He was the taller of the two. I can't.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, think about it. We'll come back to you.
The guy that played the Anchorman?
Yes.
Will Ferrell.
Will Ferrell, thank you. Will yes, he was the one there doing the cowbell in the Saturday Night Live skit.
It's amazing that I'm exhausted, but my brain still works.
Hey, I buy my first coffee. Give me a break. All right, so listen, speaking of coffee, let's hit some Frankie with some coffee music. Sing it, Lynn.
Way down among Brazilians, coffee beans
grow by the billions. So they've got to find those extra cups to fill. Hey, they got an awful lot of coffee in Brazil. All right, these are your current facts of the week, brought to you by the Bobby G and Company Show. 18 convenient locations, one near you. And as Lynn O'Brien says, just buy the coffee maker, please. Get over it. All right, so listen, we got three random facts for you. This is pretty cool. This first one's actually right up my alley. And I did not know this. Shark fossils have been found that are more than twice as old as dinosaur fossils. I never gave that any thought, but that's pretty cool.
I believe that.
And here's another one. Here's one for you. Male sea lions sometimes go 3 months without eating. That's when you're trying to get into the thong, you know, and it don't fit right. And here's one for you. This kind of makes absolutely no sense, kind of, but does in a way. The hippopotamus, that's the one that you want for Christmas, gives birth underwater but cannot swim. So they both drown, apparently. I don't know.
They wade into the water.
Yes, I figured that one out. And so there you go. And here's the male sea lion wearing a thong, hanging out with the hippopotamus that's pregnant while they dig up shark fossils version. There we go. Horny baby coming at you like a big dog in heat. All right, Lynn, what do you got for us this week?
Not a lot.
Good.
What'd you say, good?
Yeah, because I'm making up lots of time here.
Okay, I'll go quick. I could only get a handful. There wasn't a whole lot going on. I don't know if it's because the outdoor things are over with, school starting. So it was pretty thin pickings.
Okay.
So for Friday at Theodore's, I've got Down the Alley. They start at 9 o'clock. The Still is going to have the Storytellers at 6. On Saturday, Trailer Trash and Black Cadillac are going to be playing at V Street Tavern. The Still is going to have Wolf Alone at 6. On Sunday,
all right,
the Fusion Bar is going to have Shovelhead at 2. And King Cruel is going to be at the Shamrock starting at 2 o'clock.
Very good. So, hey,
that's all I can find, yeah.
Are you at the beach or are you in Ohio?
She's in the camper.
I am at the beach. I'm about 15 steps from the water.
Wow. Okay. All right, cool.
Hey, Blue Devil Blues is playing tonight in South Hadley on the Village Commons at 6:30. It's great. They're a great show. And Trailer Trash is everywhere. They're at the Sum of You Thursday, September 19th, so coming up soon. And Skyline has a big band coming up, but they have some music this weekend as well. So,
all right.
Oh, tomorrow at 7 a.m., Cobblestone Road is at the Blackboard.
This weekend?
What's that, Lynn?
Also this weekend, I forgot to mention, the Brimfield Fair is open.
Oh.
Or antique show, whatever they call it. It started, I think, today.
Okay.
And it goes the whole weekend. So that is something I've never been to and I wanted to check out.
Here's another one. Destination Bike Night at the Polish Agawam Polish Club, featuring General Gist playing out there tonight.
All right. There you go. Yep. So there's still a couple of things to do.
That's the last one.
And you got the Brimfield Fair. So if you live anywhere near to the Big E and you want to get a fix before the tourists start killing you, go out to the Brimfield. Experience those tourists.
And if you're me and you want to go across the street so you can stumble home.
There you go.
At Bright Ideas Brewing, Kitty and the Beard tonight at 6 o'clock.
There you have it. Right next to the Dollar General.
She's no, they're right across the street.
Very good.
Yeah. Kitty
Isn't that and the a beard, Dollar yep. General across the street from you too?
Yeah.
Okay, there you go. So you can... stock up on your electrolytes. All right, so listen, let's jump into some Dark Shadows. Woo! Right, this is our segment called Dark Shadows. It is my editorial piece. It can be political. It can be paranormal. It can be a B&T. It can be about something that frosted my cookies that I saw on TV. This week, I decided to be nice. So on this week's edition of Dark Shadows, I'm going to go paranormal for a bit of a change, since the political world hasn't really changed all that much from last week, with the exception of Harris finally conceding that she's going to follow the originally agreed upon rules for the debate on the 10th. But I'm not going to slam that. All right. So I don't need a disclaimer, Pete. You can put it on hold for this week. Now, as most, if not all of you already know, I am the founder and the director of Agawam Paranormal. This has been a labor of love for 17 years now for me, and I can tell you that it truly doesn't feel like it has been anywhere near to that duration. But I guess that is the way it is when you love to do something so much. If anyone had told me all that time ago that I would still be doing this to the level that we are, I would have thought that they were insane. Remember, this was intended to be a small family distraction and not the ever-evolving team that it has become. I am very protective of my team's reputation and have been since the very beginning, even going so far as to remove potential pitfalls from within the growing roster. Over the years, I have had two different groups of members leave to form their own identities with new teams. To my knowledge, both have failed. I actually blame myself for that, because there is a lot of work that I do behind the scenes that make ready for an investigation. Believe it or not, the investigation only happens after a lot of work and coordinating has been done first. Before the very first EMF meter is picked up, we have invested several weeks working on a case. From the initial email correspondence, to the phone conversations, to the initial client interview, to the research, there is a ton of work being done by Agawam Paranormal prior to our very first investigation. But since I don't needlessly include the non-essential members to that level of detail, it always looks like it's an easy task to handle a case. Nope. Once people realize that the end is actually work, they can quickly become overwhelmed. Now, we are coming into the fall season, which of course means my busiest time of the year. Since Halloween is only 2 months away, people's thoughts naturally turn to things that go bump in the night. The house has been closed up for months now, with the air conditioners running almost the entire summer. Folks can forget what their house sounds like when open to the wind. Creaks and groans are now much more audible as the house settles with the cooling temperatures. Or maybe Casper just likes the air conditioning and isn't happy that it's off now. Who knows? No matter what the cause, this is the time when I get a ton of emails asking for an investigation. Well, this year is already booked solid, and actually has been for several months now, that doesn't prevent me from starting to book dates for our 18th year. Truth be told, I've already laid out the groundwork for several new cases for the next year that will take us into early summer of 2025. Sounds like a lot for a simple family hobby, especially from a schmuck like me that isn't anyone special, but just a man with a very cool hobby. The other thing that we bring to the table for the local or Massachusetts communities are the many different library events that we do, from Roe to the Cape and everywhere in between. We have a working relationship with 63 different libraries in our state alone. With absolutely no speaking fees incurred for any of our presentations, it becomes very easy and budget-friendly for a library to book an event. The request that I have come to simply, the request that I have come to simply love are the trunk or treat events. The little kids just get the biggest kick out of meeting my crew and getting some awesome candy too. We have a Casper costume that one of my people will wear and circulate through the crowd. Photo opportunities are also given for the bravest little kiddies. Even the parents have a blast here too. All of this is added to our regular schedule. This is what makes for a very busy season for us. All of the investigation dates are booked well in advance, but the extra dates for the talks and the kids make it a very full few months. Don't get me wrong here. It's busy, but I wouldn't have it any other way. Keep in mind that Agawam Paranormal is a completely money-free group. This means that there is never a charge to any client for an investigation. No travel expenses, and I don't even accept donations. Even when we do a library event, they are completely free. Now, to put this into perspective, the going rate for a paranormal speaker is around $350 an hour. Considering that my presentations are on average 90 minutes, that would be a $500 bill. I don't charge a penny for any of it. This is just my way of giving back to the different communities and the families that live there. Since we are completely non-monetary, that means that I don't have a budget for advertising. All of ours come from happy library patrons or clients. We also have an annual ghost hunting event with my very good friend, Mr. Chris Paisano from Western Mass News. Every year we bring Chris and his film crew out to a location, local location that is, for a taped ghost hunt that he plays on or near Halloween each year. This will be our 11th consecutive year doing this together, even through COVID. I guess paranormal investigators were essential personnel too. This piece always generates a lot of emails too, from possible new cases to potential new members, and we love to hear from each and every one of you. So in closing, so as the weather starts to cool and the nights get darker earlier, just ask yourself, is that really the house settling? Stay haunted, my friends. So there you go with Dark Shadows this week. And there you have it. So beyond that, why don't we jump right into the best song on radio, any show, any station, anywhere. Sing it, Lynn! All right, this is Bobby's Thinking Outside of the Box. This is where I will give Lynn and Pete a trivia question, give them four possible answers, and one of them is correct. So let's see if today is a lucky day for either one of them, although I do think that this is an easy question. Your question today for both of you, how long have penguins been around? Okay, you got four guesses here. How long have penguins been around? Is it A, 40 million years? B, 800 years, C, 50 years, or D, 20,000 years? Lynn, I'll hit you first. 40 million, 800? 20,000. I'm sorry? Go, say again?
20,000.
It's 40 million or 20,000?
20,000.
20,000. You're going with D. What do you think, Pete?
20,000.
I'm going to agree with her. 20,000.
No, you're both off. It's actually penguins have been around for about 40 million years. It was A. Fossils show that penguins used to fly. Back then, penguins flew to Antarctica, where there was plenty of food and no major predators. Since they had all that they needed on the ground, penguins became flightless birds and now use the same motions in swimming that the that land birds use in flight. As Antarctica got colder, penguins adapted by developing a thick layer of fat under their skin. So there you go. 40 million years. Think about that.
That's crazy. Wow.
All right, we got our first weather report coming at you. All right, joining us again this week from the Bobby G and Company show, Sky One Weather Chopper, my wife and our chief meteorologist, Hope Goff. Good morning, honey.
Good morning, guys.
Morning, Hope.
Good morning, Hope.
Today will be mainly sunny with a high near 80. Tonight we'll only have a few clouds overnight and a low of 55. Sounds like a near perfect day out there.
Oh, yes, it does. Looking forward to getting out there to enjoy it. Bella just loves going for walks on days like this.
Yes, she does. Our sunrise is at 6:20 this morning, and our sunset will be at 7:16 this evening.
So what's our weekend looking like?
Well, Friday will have partly cloudy skies with a high of 79. Friday evening will start with partly cloudy skies, then becoming cloudy overnight and a low of 60. Saturday will be cloudy in the morning, then off and on showers during the afternoon with a high of 76. Saturday evening will have a steady rain with showers and continuing late and a low of 52. Now, Sunday will be mainly sunny with a high around 70. Sunday evening will stay clear with a low of 49.
Getting chilly. Hey, you know, it's easier to take a rainy Saturday when you have a beautiful Sunday to look forward to. Well, I know that you need to get ready for your day after you bring Sky One back to her secret base. So have a nice day, and I'll see you later.
Sounds good. Have an awesome show, guys. This is the Chief Meteorologist for the Bobby G and Company show, Hope Goff, signing off until next time. Reminding you, as always, to try to take a moment to enjoy the weather. Have a safe weekend. Also, remember that most of the children have returned to school. Use some additional caution when driving and always respect the laws where school buses are concerned. Never pass one while their lights are flashing.
Oh, there you go. Good advice. At 6:41 in the morning, we've got 52 degrees in the Tri-Town area of Agawam, Southwick, and Westfield. And that brings us into that sinking feeling that we're going to experience right now. And... Yeah.
Come on, it's a good song.
It's yeah. So, Lynn, what did you give us? What did you give us this week?
All right, this week I went with Earth, Wind, and Fire. One of my favorite songs by them is, ironically, September.
There you go. It's perfect for today, beginning of September. Bobby G and Company, the co-host choice.
Clouds. Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Hey, this is Dean Cain. You're listening to my friends Robbie, Lynn, and Pete on the Bobby G and Company Show on WSKB 89.5 FM. I'm also listening right alongside
Mr. Dean Cain. Awesome sauce there.
Yeah, our buddy.
Definitely that. So good thing there. Good times. So today's theme was actually favorite songs. And so you just heard Lynn's choice there with September from Earth, Wind, and Fire, which is actually a good song. And I guarantee you my wife Hope was at home dancing away to that because that's one of her favorites too. And so the next two songs, I'm actually going to do them as a double play for you, are two that that stand out for me. One of my favorite bands from back in the day is Kansas. And there's so many B-sides that they did that are just as good as Dust in the Wind, Carry On Wayward Son, that's what I went with today. So the first song you're going to hear is from Kansas. It's called Play the Game Tonight. Awesome, awesome song. And then the next one, again, another B-side, but this one's also awesome.
Oh, yeah.
From back in the, I think it came off of Love Stinks, so that was 1980. The Jay Giles Band with No Anchovies, Please. Bobby G and Company, we're right back after this double play.
This is the story of a young couple
in Portland, Maine. While waiting for her husband, Don, to return home from work, she reaches for a can of anchovies. As she spreads the tiny fish across a piece of lettuce, she notices a small note at the bottom of the can. Written on it is a telephone number. Curious, she dials and is told,
"Don't move, lady. We'll be right over."
Placing the phone back on the hook, she turns to see three smartly dressed men standing in her kitchen doorway. Before she realizes what is happening to her, she is rolled tightly in long sheets of cellophane, transported to an international airport, and placed on a waiting jetliner. All this being too much for her to comprehend, she passes out. Upon awakening, she finds herself in a strange, foreign-speaking nation. Alone, fearing her escape impossible, she seeks comfort in the arms of a confidential agent. With a trace of her kiss still warm upon his lips, he betrays her to the hands of three scientists who are engaged in diabolical avant-garde experiments previously performed only on insects and other small, meaningless creatures. Using her as their subject, they are delighted with the results. For the first time, a human being is transformed into a... Meanwhile, back in Portland, Maine. Her husband, Don, now chain-smoking 40 packs of cigarettes a day, sits at a local bar and has a few beers with the regulars. Bored, everyone's attention turns to the television set that just hangs from the wall.
Welcome to Bowling for Dollars.
Suddenly, Crazy Al says,
Say, Don, there sure is something familiar about that bowling ball.
To which a terrified Don replies,
Oh my God! That bowling ball! It's my wife!
And the lesson we learn from this story is, next time you place your order, don't forget to say, No anchovies, please.
There you go. Two B-side songs. Awesome tunage. So listen, Pete, why don't we jump into some Mason Williams? We got some classical gas coming at you, just like Taco Bell. Always get the hiccups.
Hot soda.
Yeah, exactly. I am drinking a seltzer, yeah. So it's a Mason Williams classical gas. I love this song. Always reminds me of my folks. So this is the time of the show for everybody's favorite morning show game segment. It's called Three Headlines and a Lie. Now I'm going to read Pete and Lynn four headlines. One of them is made up. Let's see if they and you can pick out the false headline. All right, here we go. Number one. Indiana judge rules tacos, burritos are sandwiches. Okay? Tacos and burritos are sandwiches. Number two, Sarah Paulson calls out actor who emailed her 6 pages of notes after watching her. Number three, I'm a CEO who microdoses magic mushrooms as part of my morning routine. It helps me feel more productive and empathetic. And then finally, number four, inside the masterclass as campaign that's giving away free allergy pills to one person for life. So one of those four headlines is fake. Is it the Indiana judge with the tacos and burritos? Sarah Paulson calling out the actor? CEO who microdoses mushrooms, or the masterclass campaign that's giving away free allergy pills for life. Which one do you think, Lynn?
Four.
The masterclass with the pills?
Yep.
Okay,
Pete. Yeah, I agree with her on that one.
You do? Well, you're both right. You're both right on this one this week. Yeah, congratulations.
Yeah, so we haven't been right in a while.
It has been. But you know, you're like the broken watch. Eventually, twice a day. You know.
Yeah,
all right.
Come on.
So listen, we got the word of the day for you, which is a follow-up to the headlines. Nadir, N-A-D-I-R. Have you ever heard of that word? Do you know what it means, Pete?
No.
It means the lowest point. So there you go. You just got him an edumacation. And that ends Classical Gas. And
you even finished on time.
I did. Look at that. Morning Brew. So listen, we are getting ready for Legend Hunters, but I got time for Les's making a Les list. So let's jump right into that. All right. We got Chris Jericho's entry music for making a Les list.
Chip, you know what? You just made the list. Oh, no.
Oh, here we go.
All right, keep in mind, when I sent out the message this week, giving the theme, I told them that they could play any song that they liked, even country this week. I was really sticking my neck out there. And Les, being a wisecracker, went with a seldom heard, little known Rolling Stones song called Faraway Eyes. And if this isn't pseudo country, I don't know what is. So here you go. We're making a Les list.
Sunday morning through Bakersfield, listening to gospel music on the colored radio station. And the preacher said, you know, you always have the Lord by your side. And I was so pleased to be informed of this that I ran 20 red lights in his honor. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I had an arrangement to meet a girl, and I was kind of late. And I thought by the time I got there, she'd be off with the nearest truck driver she could find. Much to my surprise, I got a prayer for the girl
All I gotta say is how much drugs Rolling Stones were doing when they wrote that song.
I don't know, but I could tell you right now, and that song was 4 minutes and 28 seconds long. That song killed more brain cells in that brief period of time than all the years of smoking weed in my days of youth. I'm just pointing that out to you. Thank you for that, Les.
Yeah.
So listen.
That was pretty bad.
It was 7:02 in the morning, and it is that time, folks. I know you've been waiting for. You're on the edge of your seat. Let's go with episode 10 of season one. This wraps up season one of the series that you've come to know and love, called Legend Hunters. Bobby G and Company. We're right back after this. Here we go. Everybody, this is Bobby Goff. You may know me from the Bobby G and Company show, or maybe from Agawam Paranormal. 17 years doing ghost hunting and all that, it's kind of obvious that I'm interested in things that not only go bump in the night, but things that make me scratch my head and say, I wonder. So with that thought in mind, we decided to come up with a whole new television show, a new series that is going to be looking and examining cryptids. Now, by cryptids, what I'm talking about are the ones that everybody knows. We got Bigfoot. We've got the Loch Ness Monster. We've got the Dover Demon was actually a very interesting one. And those are just three of the examples that we're going to be talking about throughout this series. So with that in mind, I invite you, get in your favorite recliner, full of popcorn, your beverage right there with you. Sit back, enjoy, and be prepared to be entertained. And who knows, maybe you'll learn a few things about some of these cryptids too. With that in mind, here we go. Hey, everybody. Bobby Goff and the Campfire Crew back with you again. One final time. This is our last episode of season one. This is episode 10. And I am joined by my heartfelt, closest family, my sister from another mister, Mrs. Lynn O'Brien. How are you doing tonight, Lynn?
I am just ducky.
Ducky. Oh, I got to share a tale with you later on duckies. My wife, Hope, how you doing, hon?
Fine, thank you.
You were able to park Sky One
over.
We got a clearing for you. Good.
Yeah. Will you fly me home?
Absolutely.
My chainsaw guy who was cutting down the trees to get it where Sky One could land. My brother and my mother. Say, I got sister, mister, and brother, mother. My buddy, Rick. How you doing tonight, brother?
Oh, peachy.
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 Peachy. Oh, my God. Everybody's so upbeat.
Ducky. It's like,
he's going to be going into a diabetic coma here in a minute. All right,
I don't know. We
have done, this is again our 10th episode of season one. We've done nine previous to this, obviously, on different cryptids, kind of specific. Like, for example, we did Bigfoot, we did Pupwudgies, which was fun. We did Chupacabra, the Jersey Devil, the Dover Demon, all of these things.
Excuse me.
What I'm going to throw at you this week, we're instead of analyzing one cryptid like we have been doing, we're going to mix it up just a little bit. I'm going to hit you with a location. Now, this is again a Massachusetts based show. And so I've got for you tonight, we're going to talk about a little mythical place known as the Bridgewater Triangle.
Oh, Lord.
And, this is three points. Abington is 1 point, Freetown is another, and then Rehoboth being the third. And these are rough points. And it forms a triangular shape that has all kinds of stuff happening inside of it. You've got state park in there that's huge. Many, many reports of paranormal activity, cryptids, all kinds of stuff. What's cool about this is it's not too far from here in Western Mass. If you go to the town of Taunton, you're in the middle of the Bridgeport, or the Bridgewater Triangle. I don't know why I always want to do a Bridgeport being a town. But yeah, so it's easily doable for somebody. You know, I always hear when we're doing a presentation with Agawam Paranormal, oh, you know, me and my girlfriend or me and my mom, we love doing this. We like going to these places. Well, here you go. I just gave you literally a 200 square mile area that you can go and check out and maybe, just maybe, find something for yourself. So Bridgewater Triangle, let's throw this out there on the floor. What do you think, Lynn?
Oh, absolutely. There is so much evidence in this area. There's no way that some of this isn't true.
Yes, some of it has to.
Oh, it has to be. I mean, when you look at some of the locations, I mean, state parks, Bridgewater State University.
Yep.
The an old one-room schoolhouse.
Yep.
Native American curses. I mean, it's just like, I'm surprised nobody's made a movie out of all this stuff because, you know, when I went to research it, it was just pages and pages and pages of, you know, it's got to be something. I mean,
yeah.
You don't have all that information and not have something be real.
And all kinds of that.
Yeah.
All different things.
All different things. All different people have come forward, and it's not just kids or old folks that want to believe it. It's all different
Everybody.
People have yep. seen all kinds of different things.
Yep.
So to me, absolutely. I'd go there tomorrow.
Do you remember, I don't know if you, I'm sure you will once I say it to you, my friend John Brightman?
Oh, absolutely. We did Scarecon with him.
With John Brightman, yeah, at Scarecon. And he actually lived in that area.
Did he move?
Did a lot. I'm not sure if he did or not, but I think he did. But he was doing extensive research in the Bridgewater Triangle. And he was telling me that the stuff is real. It's happened.
It's happened in his house
yeah.
where he lived with his parents.
Because yeah.
we had a huge conversation that weekend about it. And even his own house, he had stuff going on. So
John was a great guy.
He was. Is, he was fun. He was fun.
He was, yeah, he was not what I expected.
Yep.
Given being given by the promoter of Scarecon that year, literally a 5-minute heads up that I'm doing a panel with John Brightman from Ghost Adventures. And I'm like, what? Who? And start talking to this guy at the door going in. I have no idea who he is. And introduced ourselves and, oh, who's John Brightman? This guy I'm going to be on stage with. And he was so easy to work with. Within, I'll say 20 minutes, we were finishing each other's sentences.
And, that was a good panel. I watched
sure
that.
He
gave, that was good.
It was a good mix. It was a very good mix because he was giving more of a global feel of the places that he traveled, whereas my contribution was the local aspect of things. And we were just having a blast talking. It was a one-hour panel that could have gone 3 hours easily. And we had a lot of fun, like you were saying.
It was, yeah, well, it was good.
Well received. But yeah, now John living in that area, you know, obviously it's a point of interest for him, and he got all into it. He was working on that the whole time that he was there. But like you said, because of his personal experiences, the hiccups, hell of a time for the hiccups. So it must be a puck wedgie's coming to effect. He's gonna shout with a poison dart. So hun, what's your thought?
Well, I think it's cool that there are so many different kinds of reports, like UFOs and Bigfoot and, you know, poltergeists and thunderbirds and giant snakes. And there's just so much activity, like you said, Lynn, reported by so many people.
Yeah, different people.
You know, it's not like one thing that someone saw.
Right.
All yeah. different things.
And it's been for people. For years.
Yep.
Yeah, forever.
It's
yep.
not just 1999 and then never again. I mean, it's just been.
And like the college that has haunted buildings.
Yep, it has yep. a haunted
State
dorm.
Park. Yeah. That.
Yeah, pretty crazy.
Hospital.
Like Bridgewater State?
Yeah.
What do you think, Rick?
I think that, yeah, there's a lot of stuff that
what I was reading, there's a lot of stuff that happened there. Some of it's got to be true.
It's such a variety.
Oh, yeah. It's all sorts of different things.
We talked about a location. It's Bigfoot active. Okay, yeah. We talked about another location. Pukwudgie active. Okay, Chupacabras. Dover Demons. I mean, we all have all of these places, geographical locations. But then we put in an actual location and see what we get. And it's almost like looking at it from the reverse angle. And here, Bridgewater Triangle, again, it's in the southeastern part of Massachusetts, 200 square miles altogether, approximately.
Didn't they have some cults there? Cult problems there?
Yes, there was a cult. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, there's all kinds of cult problems. One of the places that they had issues with, I'm trying to remember where the occult stuff was.
I can't remember the area where it was either.
I did write it down and I can't see it.
It was the Freetown Fall River State Forest. That's what was throwing me because it's Freetown and Fall River. That was a state forest that actually is known for cult gatherings.
Yeah.
And they've had Satanists go in there their satanic rituals, exactly.
Gangland
murders and suicides, all in this forest. And we haven't even touched on the Pukwudgies yet.
I'd love to see
a Pukwudgie.
Taunton, according to my notes, Taunton in the 1960s to 1970s, there was some major satanic cults in there.
Yeah.
That were really, there was a problem. Yeah.
Well, you've got other landmarks that are in there, like Profile Rock, which actually I don't believe is still there. I think that's been destroyed or fallen. There's ghost activity there. People reported seeing a spirit. I believe it was of a man.
Yeah. They call it Suicide Rock now.
Well, no, Suicide Rock is another one. That's actually Solitude Stone, and it's also referred to as Suicide Stone. Whole different place. Mm-hmm. But you're right. That's another one that's right in that area. You got the Bridgewater State University. I think you would mention when you had mentioned.
Yep.
The dorm rooms have ghost activity. Okay. You know, I mean, again, we're seeing, I mean, it's still in a triangular area, but, and then we get back to our old buddy, Lauren Coleman, with a cryptozoologist that was doing some study work in here. He was the one back in the 70s that originally penned the name Bridgewater Triangle. And it just kind of stuck. He put it into one of the books that he had written, and it stuck. But you've got the Taunton State Hospital. Well, we know. I mean, you know, we've heard stories many, many times about hospitals, especially state ones, mm-hmm. and the paranormal activity that's on those locations.
Oh, sir, there was so much suffering going on there. How could you not have something?
A lot of the state hospitals, asylums, basically.
The mental hospitals,
Yep. So
Massachusetts has got its share.
You know, nothing really new then. Mm-hmm. You know, but like I think you mentioned, it was a school that was a one-room school.
Yep.
That, again, ghost activity. But they think it's the ghosts of the students that used to go there.
Right. It was a school from 1840 to 1937. And Hornbine School is what Hornbine, it was called. So.
And that building's still there.
Yeah, but it's not a school or anything.
No, it's not a school. But, I mean, that kind of almost reminds me a little bit of the old schoolhouse in Storrington Village. We found activity when we investigated years back. Agawam Paranormal did the first ever investigations on Storrington Village. And when we went in there, we were there on three different occasions. We got activity that pointed to students and a teacher in the schoolhouse there.
I remember that. That night.
So... Yeah, I mean, who knows? I mean,
I don't know, maybe the teacher's got the kids staying after class a little later than usual.
They're all in detention.
They were bad kids. But since we have a lot of swamp in that area, you know, there's a lot of undeveloped area in there. And people report seeing UFOs. And, I mean, you're literally only 20 minutes from Dover, from the northern peak of the triangle to Dover. So, again, now we're going back. Lynn had expressed in the previous episode her theory about the Dover demon being extraterrestrial. We see UFO activity in the Bridgewater Triangle. Is it possible that one of the ETs went for a walk and was exploring? I don't know. I mean, I'm kind of trying to come up with a reason, but who knows? There have been reports of unnatural animals in the woods in the Bridgewater Triangle. And again, that's all part of the swamp.
Was it, weren't you just saying something about giant snakes?
Giant snakes.
Yeah, that was one of the other things, giant snakes. Yeah. So, I mean, I don't know. Yeah. Bigfoot activity in there, okay. Again, we had a perfect location in swamp. You're not going to build that up. You got to, you know, what are you going to do? So Bigfoot have been reported in there. As we talked, we have ghost activity. We have poltergeist activity. And this one's kind of interesting. I have personally experienced this twice, so I know this one's legit. Can I prove it? No, but I do know it's legit from firsthand. Shadow people.
Yeah.
And they've been reported quite a bit in Bridgewater Triangle in different buildings. So, you know, I've encountered them twice during investigations with Agawam Paranormal. And it's a shadow, just like a person we cast, except instead of it being on the floor and a wall, it's standing up right next to you. And it actually looks like a person in feature, but there's no detail, no coloration, no nothing. It's just a shadow, a dark shadow.
What do you think about the Thunderbirds?
Well, you think about it, we already mentioned unnatural animals. So they're not talking, by Thunderbird, they're not talking about like a flaming phoenix or anything like that. It's just a massive bird. Some people have actually described it as being similar to a pterodactyl. Again, you got so many people that are seeing it. I don't know.
But if we've got so many people seeing it and it's been going on for so long, why are there no pictures? No pictures, no video?
Yeah, I don't know.
Good point.
Yeah,
no pictures, no video.
Good, that's a good question.
Yeah.
We need to go.
Road trip. Okay, let's go.
Back the trucks.
Jump in the RV.
Yeah.
I'm with you.
Yep.
You know, they're keeping in mind, you know, all the cult activity. Just talking about that with the Satanists, I'm going to combine them together. Who knows what the hell they've released?
Oh.
You know, with their rituals and their rites and all that stuff, and, you know, doing sacrifices. Whether, you know, I mean, extreme end of it being human sacrifice. You know, who knows? Who knows what they've done, you know, to that land? You know, we don't. You know, we have no idea. I don't know. But then, everybody's favorite, the little Pukwudgies. I mean, they're active in that area. I actually asked John Bergman about that. He told me that he did believe them. You know, I mean, he lived in it. He researched it. Jeff Belanger, another friend of mine within the world of the paranormal, you know, he's talked a lot about the Bridgewater Triangle. And it does seem to be a hot spot in Massachusetts. Unfortunately, it's a 200-square-mile hot spot. So, I mean, if it was something like, oh, yeah, we got this 2-acre area, and every 3 days we have a UFO encounter, okay, we got something we can set up cameras in and easily capture. But 200 square miles for approximation, it's a little tough.
That's a lot of wireless cameras.
A little tough, yeah, a little tough to get that. But now that kind of, if you think about it, we talked about, again, Dover Demon. We just brought that back up again. UFOs being sighted in the Bridgewater Triangle. What if some of the Bigfoot activity, the Pukwudgies, the Dover Demon. I mean, what if these were examples of different species of ETs? They land there, then they walk around and they research, or they, you know, reconnoiter the area. I mean,
yeah, who knows? Possible.
I mean, there's been many ties between Bigfoot and UFOs. You know, Bigfoot's a sighting right after a UFO sighting. So who knows? I mean, it's possible. Could a Pukwudgie just be in the same boat as that? And if you think about it, going back to Indian folklore with all these cryptids, if you have an advanced enough civilization contacting a primitive enough civilization, the advanced one's going to appear magical by nature because we don't understand the technology that we're witnessing. Who knows? I mean, I've read many times about Bigfoot having cloaking ability. You know, you can be looking right at it and you can't see it. You're looking right around it. And supposedly it has something to do with their hair and the pattern of their hair on their bodies. I don't know. That was one that I just could not wrap my head around. Pukwudgies apparently also have the ability to disappear. Okay. Similar trait. You know, the Dover Demon. He was only seen three times, four if you count earlier. I don't know. You know, what could it be? I don't know. It's almost like that Men at Work song. Who could it be now? I don't know. So, I mean, there's so much here because the Broadbrook. Yeah, I'm going to Broadbrook Opera House. Bridgewater Triangle is just such a huge location. And it covers so many specific topics. It's not something that you can really generalize. You would have to, if you were to investigate this like John did and Jeff did, you would have to go in there and actually experience it firsthand. Doing like we did, which was looking up the scholastic end of things, does not do this location justice. it's something I believe, right, wrong, and you guys tell me, it's something I believe. This one, you have to go there and experience it. And by experience it, will you see a Bigfoot? A UFO or a Pukwudgie? I don't know. But that's part of the experience. If not, if you go camping, you love camping. You go camping in the Bridgewater Triangle somewhere. At the very least, you had a good weekend. You know? But were you being watched?
Bring your equipment with you.
Yeah.
I don't go anywhere without mine.
No. You know, it's a little bit different when we're talking about a geographical location as opposed to a cryptid associated with a religion. This is one, it's close enough to home, an hour away. You know, like I said, if you drive to Taunton, smack dab in the middle of the triangle, you know, you go after that and you start looking around. Go to the different towns, explore, have some fun with it, see what happens. Hey, who knows?
That could be an awesome vacation.
Could be.
Take a whole week and just go from location to location.
You would have to like almost Google.
Blast.
You'd have to like almost Google paranormal locations within the Bridgewater Triangle and then make yourself a map.
Yep.
And this day I want to go here. This day I want to go here. This day I want to bring my wife to the swamp. Then, you know, this
then
way.
Then Suicide Rock. And,
remember the Pukwudgies push on the cliff.
They also give wedgies, so you better watch it.
Talking with a higher voice.
Poison darts.
Poison little pygmy darts.
Yeah.
But dipped in their poison. I don't know.
That's right.
I don't know. This one, I mean, really, based on everything that we've talked about in previous episodes, as well as this particular one here, I dare say that we can't say no to this. This is fake. This is bunk.
Mm-hmm.
It's got to be right. It's got to be a yes. This one isn't so much a leaning towards. It's almost a definite yes. What do you throw them something with that?
There's got to be some of the stories have to be true.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I mean, you get my point.
Yeah, most definitely.
Okay, good. Lynn, what do you think? I mean, am I right with you on this?
Is it all true?
Oh, no, no, I'm not saying all.
I don't know if it's all true.
Let's say it all.
There's a big hunk of it that I think there's a lot going on there. It could be perception. It, you know, you don't know, but to have that much activity in that area for years, just repeating itself, it's got to be something. There's no way. There's no way that it's all fake.
Mm.
So I have to agree with you.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not saying all of it is real mm-hmm. or true. Again, misrepresentation is a huge thing. You know, three people see the same thing, they have three different descriptions.
Right. Perception.
But yeah, exactly. But some of it, to me, has to be, because it's just mm-hmm. so much of it. You throw enough crap against the wall, some of it's going to stick. you know, I mean, and to me, this is that for an example. What do you think with your brand new clipboard?
I have a quote.
You have a quote?
From your friend, Jeff Belanger.
Jeff Belanger, my buddy.
He said, no matter what you believe, there is something special happening within the three walls of the triangle. He believes there's paranormal activity that goes on there, whether it's a vortex or not.
So, yeah. But,
and he lives out that way too, doesn't he?
He does. Yeah. He's not, I don't believe Jeff lives in the triangle, but he's closer to Boston.
Right.
But so there you have it. What's your take?
There's activity there that's, some of it's got to be. It's got to be real. Yeah. Yep, absolutely. Mm-hmm. There's so many different kinds of reports of different kinds of activity.
It's almost everything. It's almost everything that we've talked about for 8 episodes. You know,
that's why I say the Bridgewater Triangle for last.
The Bigfoot and the Wedgie Dude and the UFOs and, you know, it's everything we've talked about for the past 8 episodes. In 200 miles of Massachusetts, like, it doesn't get any better than that. Let's go.
No, yeah, it's pretty tough. You know,
let's go.
And, you know, when you're dealing with something, you know, specific locations, you know, it's not just a general area. You know, they're referring to specific locations
mm-hmm.
where all these things are happening.
And they keep happening.
Yeah, it's repetitive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So... I don't know.
Let's do it.
Unfortunately, the Bigfoot aspect of it and the Pukwudgie being environmental creatures, you know, that would be, you'd be camping in the swamp with all that stuff. And
no, thank you.
You know, that one there, yeah, not my cup of tea.
I don't want the giant snakes either.
It might have been 25, 30 years ago, I'd have been on top of that one. Let me tell you, go camping. Let's do it. And take out my tactical vest.
Might have to bring my gun with me.
We could go. But nowadays, nah, 58 years old, my days doing that in the past behind me. And hell, I have a hard enough time tying my own shoes. But I don't know. Yeah, I think that there's got to be something to it. And, you know, as far as the Casper end of things, we've seen firsthand over the 17 years of doing this with Agawam Paranormal that Casper can be anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of these historical places, for example, that we drive by without a second thought can have and sometimes do have activity. And historical figures that just loved where they were. And they're just watching the world go by. I don't know. Bridgewater Triangle?
They don't discriminate.
No. Is there something about the Bridgewater Triangle that an energy source or connectivity that allows for all of this stuff to be concentrated in one area?
Could be.
I don't know.
Blanchard said it did a vortex.
Yeah. He was referring to a vortex. Yeah. Unfortunately, I don't know. And when I do have the answers, I won't be able to share them in episode 11. But we got 10 of them. Woohoo!
Yeah.
So you've got enough time here. You can sit back and you can watch all these back to back to back and who knows, get some chuckles out of it. Maybe, just maybe, even get a new way of looking at something that you've known about for many years, just never gave it any extra thought. That happened to me while putting this together and you know, producing the show, the research that went into it, that was huge. And I also do want to acknowledge and thank the three of you guys for all the work that you put into your parts of this show. I know you all did extensive research. Matter of fact, Rick was watching as many videos as he could find. The problem was he had the wrong cryptids for that week.
Slightly unprepared this week.
Slightly unprepared, going by the Reader's Digest notes. Hey, that's okay. That's the fun part about doing a show like this. And that's why it's if you hadn't figured it out, it's really not scripted. This is very much so shooting from the hip. And we do have highlighted notes that we refer to. This is no way you're going to memorize 10 episodes worth of dates. It ain't going to happen. So we do have a little cheat sheet with the notes in front of us. So giving that away. But it was fun. I think, dare I say, we all had a good time.
Absolutely.
One. For sure. Yeah.
Did you enjoy it? And I know you were a little camera shy at first doing this, but you loved the idea of, and the subject matter. Did that win you over by the end? Because you look very comfortable. Your first episode.
I didn't say anything today.
No, but you're comfortable. The first episode, you were like, dear heaven.
No,
and then you slowly got into it. And Hope tried to run you over three times with the truck.
Come on.
I'm just saying.
First episode was Bigfoot. I was very much into it.
But
I want to see us get into some other things.
Well,
that's what I said.
I want to start going into some of the paranormal stuff.
I want to do multiple things here. I'm thinking, and this is just sharing random thoughts with you. We're going to do two seasons a year. It'll be a spring and a fall, assuming everything goes well behind the scenes. The spring episodes, I really wanted to go not so much with cryptids, but with mythological beasts, like the Kraken, like the Megalodon. Things that we may know were around and maybe are still around. I'm going to look into that and see if I can put together topic matter for 10 episodes on that. And then we'll get back into the fall with something like this, whether it be cryptids. Maybe we'll do that season will be Agawam Paranormal Unplugged. We had talked about doing that for a long time. And the fall is the perfect time for that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we'll share the exploits of what we experienced as a team on different investigations around Western Mass. These are places most of them you're going to know. And best part, most of them you're going to be able to go to.
You know what'd be pretty good?
What's that?
Our own personal things that we've seen that are, whether it be with Agawam Paranormal or on your own.
Okay.
Whichever got you interested. What's going on?
Yeah, the background. We can include backgrounds with Agawam Paranormal Unplugged. What made you want to become an investigator? What piqued your interest? I mean, me, I'm going to leave you with it. It was a toilet flushing.
That's a funny story.
That's what it was. A toilet flushing made me be where I am here today. Plain and simple. I'll share that story with you if we do Agawam Paranormal Unplugged. Or you can always go to one of the library events, which are free. And come in, sit down, be entertained. And myself and my crew are always available afterwards for conversation. So you can always come up and have a good time during the show, come up and talk about your experiences. Hell, you can even reference Legend Hunters to the four of us. Hey, in episode 6, you guys said this. I think it was wrong. I think it was that. Come up. I want your feedback, especially on Legend Hunters. Is this something that's a worthwhile thing, or am I spinning my wheels and wasting our effort and time? I hope not, because we did an awesome job, I think, with this. I also want to take a huge hat off and kudos to my friend Casey Danick, who did all of the editing, filming, and everything else. He is the reason this show looks the way it looks. He's my magician. Okay. And Casey Danick, awesome. He's with Agawam Media. He's my photog whenever we cover anything for Agawam Media. And we just have a great time hanging out together. And when I first approached him with this idea, he got excited about it too. He thought it was an awesome idea. He worked out the logistics of behind the scenes, made sure he had all the new equipment that he needed. I don't know why we needed a new van, but we got it.
Don't forget the wet bar.
And the wet bar, yeah, the wet bar. I don't know why we needed that, but so anyway, it's a village that puts together a show like this. I hope you folks enjoyed season one. I can't wait to see it in the spring with season two. But as always, you can check us out, Bobby G and Company, every Thursday morning. If you want to listen on the FM, 89.5, or wherever you're watching this, also carries Bobby G and Company on Thursday mornings, starting at 6 o'clock. And if it's a school, if school is in session, we have a two-hour format. We're out at 8. However, if it's a school break, winter break, Christmas break, whatever the break may be, we run a four-hour program. So we'll be talking about all kinds of things during the show. My good friend, Little Brian, she's my co-host on it. We have a great time. My wife, Hope, sitting next to me, gives Lynn permission every week to kick me under the table.
True.
The abuse that I get, let me tell you. And with that in mind, I really, truly, and again, I know I'm broken record here. I really hope that you guys enjoyed Legend Hunters Season 1. You can check these all out. Agawam Media TV. I don't know the actual address, but Google it. It's under Agawam Media. And Binge Watch, 10 episodes. I don't know. Have a good time with it. That in mind, signing off for this week. Bobby Goff here with the Campfire crew. Again, thank you to everybody involved with this. And thank you also to the Mwaga Sportsman's Club for allowing us to actually film on site. We couldn't get a membership until September, but they still let us come in,
yes,
even though we were not members. And we got permission from the Grand Puba, and he let us come in. Thank you so much. Thank you, Vicky. Thank you, Joe. With that in mind, God bless. Take care, folks. Bobby Goff, signing off. Season 1, Episode 10.
Joining us again this week from the Bobby G and Company show, Sky One Weather Chopper, my wife and our chief meteorologist, Hope Goff. Good morning, honey.
Good morning, guys. Today will be mainly sunny with a high near 80. Tonight we'll only have a few clouds overnight and a low of 55. Sounds like a near perfect day out there.
Oh, yes, it does. Looking forward to getting out there to enjoy it. Bella just loves going for walks on days like this.
Yes, she does. Our sunrise was at 6:20 this morning, and our sunset will be at 7:16 this evening.
So what's our weekend looking like?
Well, Friday will have partly cloudy skies with a high of 79. Friday evening will start with partly cloudy skies, then becoming cloudy overnight and a low of 60. Saturday will be cloudy in the morning, then off and on showers during the afternoon with a high of 76. Saturday evening will have a steady rain with showers and continuing late and a low of 52. Now, Sunday will be mainly sunny with a high around 70. Sunday evening will stay clear with a low of 49.
Getting chilly. Hey, you know, it's easier to take a rainy Saturday when you have a beautiful Sunday to look forward to. Well, I know that you need to get ready for your day after you bring Sky One back to her secret base. So have a nice day, and I'll see you later.
Sounds good. Have an awesome show, guys. This is the chief meteorologist for the Bobby G and Company show, Hope Goff, signing off until next time. Reminding you, as always, to try to take a moment to enjoy the weather. Have a safe weekend. Also, remember that most of the children have returned to school. Use some additional caution when driving, and always respect the laws where school buses are concerned. Never pass one while their lights are flashing.
All right, good advice, good advice. Sky One flies back to her secret base for the day. 54 degrees out there currently in the Tri-Town area of Agawam, Southwick, and Westfield. Now, I hope you guys enjoyed the final episode of Season 1 of Legend Hunters. We had a blast bringing it to you. But I am crammed for time, so I'm going to jump right into Pete's pick of the week. And let's see what Pete picked for his favorite song.
Pete, what was your favorite song?
My song was more about emotion than my favorite. It's kind of my favorite, and it's a very emotional song to me.
Yes, I know.
A lot of context in that one. And I picked The Living Years by Mike and the Mechanics.
Awesome song, and like you said, very, very emotional. All right, here comes Pete's pick. We got Mike and the Mechanics. Let's be right back.
Baby. truth, I just wish I could have told him in the living years. So say, say, say it loud.
I hate having a new phone.
What's that?
Can I just say I hate having a new phone?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, but you got a nice phone there, so.
I understand that, but nothing's now set up, and I'm trying to access stuff, and
oh,
it's not working.
Gotcha,
it's annoying.
Gotcha. All right. So, listen, we've got 7:46 at the time, and I've got one more piece of business that I have to get done. So this is Hope's Catch of the Week. Let's jump right back into that. All right, once again, we got the sounds of the surf and the seagulls in the background. Must mean only one thing. It's got to be Hope's Catch of the Week. So this week, I told everybody, just go with your favorite song. And Hope actually went somewhere I didn't expect her to go. So, hon, what did you pick for a favorite?
I picked 38 Special, Hold On Loosely.
Any special reason for that?
Well, you said favorite, and it is one of my favorites. Kind of a cute story way back in the day when I worked a little ways from home. One of my coworkers had a not very nice car. I had a brand new car, but they had a beautiful stereo system. So we used to swap cars and drive home, and I could listen to the great music, and this was one of the songs I used to play on repeat.
Oh, okay. So good memories.
Yes, absolutely.
All right. So, do you have any parting thoughts you want to throw in there as well?
No, wishing all the kids, you know, a happy school year now that they're back.
All right. So, hey, this is Hope's Catch of the Week. You're listening to the Bobby G and Company Show right here on WSKB 89.5. Or maybe you're catching us on your local channel through cable, through WCPC. Either way, sit back, relax, enjoy. Got some 38 Special, Hold On Loosely. Pete, hit that red button, buddy. All right, 38 special with Holding On Loosely. I've got one of the students from the Tech Academy. You can't see her. She's off camera. But Sophia has sat in with me for Amy's Father's Terrible Dad Jokes of the Week. Let's hope that the button works. All right, I asked Sophia to come in because I know she loves these dad jokes and gets a kick out of some of them. She laughs and gives me an honest review. So, Lynn and Pete, get ready. Here comes four of Amy's Father's Terrible Dad Jokes. The first one, why can't a nose be 12 inches long? Why can't a nose be 12 inches long? Any idea?
No.
Because then it would be a foot. Get it? 12 inches is a foot? Okay, I had to explain that one. All right. Here's one All right. So then the next one I got for you is, why are elephants so wrinkly? Why are elephants so wrinkly?
Stress?
No, because you can't iron them.
Wilson!
Get it? You can't iron the shirt. You can't iron the elephant. Because they haven't been ironed. See, a shirt is ironed. It needs to be ironed. Okay. It's tough. And I thought Lynn was bad. All right. So here's another one for you. How did the two cats end their fight? How did the two cats end their fight?
With a mouse?
No. They hissed and made up.
Oh, like
hated it.
No, come on. All right. That one was pretty bad.
Because Oh.
They hissed instead of kissed.
Oh, okay.
Okay, see.
I
could see the little light bulb starting to light up. But anyway, all right. So the last one I got for you, why did the strawberry cry?
Because it ran out of seeds?
No.
Because I don't know.
Because he found himself in a jam.
Now you know.
The rest of the
story. That's
a
really sad joke, actually.
It is.
That's a
sad ending graphic. Actually. Yeah. That is sad. I'm going to go home and have some peanut butter and jelly or something, maybe strawberry. All right, so listen, it is 7:55. We are coming to the end of yet another episode. Yeah, I got that here too somewhere. Let's see, where the heck is that one? There it is.
Whatever.
Oh, there we go. I was going to say, now it's not going to work. But yeah, so thanks for tuning in. I hope you guys enjoyed the final episode of season one of Legend Hunters. We had a blast putting it together. I know Lynn is chomping at the bit to start with season two, and I'm really kind of holding her in the reins and making her wait till the spring. Yeah, we'll have 10 more episodes coming in the spring. So watch these 10, sit back and enjoy them, and we're going to hit you with some more before you know it. So my final song out of the gate, Lynn, I want to thank you for zooming in. We didn't get to talk much, but we had to cram in order to fit that episode in. And Pete, thank you. Sophia, thank you for sitting in.
You're welcome.
My final song I'm going to leave you with, it is 7:56 in the morning, one of my favorites. So this was when I was back in the heavy lifting days working out. This was one of my power songs from Our Lady Peace. The name of the song is Whatever. Bobby G and Company, thanks for tuning in. God bless. See you next week.